Dobar dan, poštovani gledaoci. Gledate Srpsku televiziju Toronto. Kao što smo vas obavestili u prošloj emisiji, posle iznenadnog i neočekivanog zatvaranja Rogers TV kanala 10, 26. septembra ove godine, Srpska televizija Toronto, Serbian Television Toronto, nastavlja da se emituje na sajtu www.serbiantelevision.tv svake druge subote. Srpska televizija Toronto u produkciji Blagoja Ristića, a posle njegove smrti, njegovog sina, Viktora Ristića, je prva srpska televizija u Kanadi koja već 18 godina predstavlja našu kulturu, tradiciju i religiju u ovoj multietničkoj zemlji. Sa zatvaranjem Rogers TV kanala 10, pored Srpske televizije Toronto, ukinuto je emitovanje u eter svih 18 multietničkih programa, kao i sve engleske produkcije. Poštovani gledaoci, sa vašom podrškom Srpska televizija Toronto će nastaviti da beleži značajnije događaje u našoj komuni i preko websajta i drugih socijalnih mreža bit će vam uvek dostupna u vaše slobodno vreme. Ja sam vaša voditeljka Teodora Vukosavljević i zahvaljujem vam se što ste ponovo sa nama. Emisiju počinjemo snimkom sa predavanja profesora doktora Dragana Stanića naslovljeno Kultura i identitet, koje je održano 3. juna ove godine na University of Toronto u organizaciji Srpske nacionalne akademije.
Nadam se da ne treba da se predstavljam, ali reda rade, ja sam Sofija Škorić i imamo večeras specijalnog gosta koja ću vam predstaviti, ali pre toga naš predsednik, gospodin Žarko Brestovac, želim da vas pozdravim.
U ime Srpske nacionalne akademije želim vam dobro došlicu i da se provedete divno na ovom prijemu.
Kada govorimo o tako ozbiljnoj stvari kao što je pitanje dakle, kulture i identiteta, mi sve vreme razmišljamo zapravo pitanje srpske nacionalne kulture i problema nacionalnog identiteta srpskog naroda. Mi treba da, čini mi se, promišljamo stvari tako da one budu dovoljno utemeljene, da ih postavimo na dobre osnove, da ne posežemo za nekim lakim rešenjima i da brzo hitamo ka nekim zaključcima, nego mnogo je važnije da, a to je duh, recimo, Matice Srpske, pažljivo promisliti čitavu stvar, zamisliti dugotrajne projekte, to inače u srpskoj kulturi nije baš osobina koja je na ceni, ne umemo da radimo dugotrajno, strpljivo, korak po korak, nego uvek hitamo da nešto na brzinu učinimo i da na brzim nekim postupcima dođemo do rezultata. Ako sam ja išta naučio u Matici Srpskoj i sad sve činim da i možda neki mlađi ljudi krenu upravo tim putem, onda je to upravo ta odlučnost da se na duge staze promišlja i da se radi i deluje na duge staze. Mi ponekad kažemo u Matici Srpskoj sve što ne može da se zamisli kao poduhvat od jedno 50 godina minimalno, to nije naročito vredno ulaganje. Vredno je naravno za ljudske živote i svaki ljudski život treba da sebi promisli šta bi uradio za godinu dana, za 5 godina, za 10 godina, ali kada je ustanovama reč, onda vredi zaista uložiti ogromnu kolektivnu energiju da se ostvare neki dugotrajni rezultati. Kada razmišljamo dakle o kulturi i identitetu, mogli bismo na bar dva osnovna načina da shvatimo koliko je ova relacija značajna. S jedne strane, recimo, na individualno-psihološkom planu. Za svakoga od nas je značajan i pojam kulture, značajan i pojam identiteta. Svako od nas bi valjalo da promišlja o tim stvarima, naprosto da bi osmislio sopstveni život, da bi vodio sopstveni život, vodio ga onim procesima individuacije tako da se naši životi realizuju sa što potpunijim smislom, koji na kraju života, kada podvučemo crtu, onda kažemo, eto, zbog toga smo živjeli, to smo učinili u životu. I dobro je da se čovjek na vreme s tim pitanjima suoči, što ranije, to bolje, da ne bude opet previše rano, da to slomi mladog čoveka, nego da čovjek na vreme postavi ta pitanja i da onda krene tragom rešavanja upravo takvih pitanja. Na individualnom psihološkom planu, dakle, svako od nas mora da prvo utvrdi nekakav sopstveni identitet, da se pita ko je i šta je, zašto ga je Bog dao, šta bi trebalo da čini u životu da bi osmislio sopstveni život. Ako on počne ta pitanja da postavlja i da ih rešava, onda on ulazi u onaj drugi korak koji je neophodan kada razmišljamo o odnosu kulture i identiteta, a to je nesumnjiva važnost samosvesti i samospoznaje. Još od hrama u Delfima ostao je onaj epigraf spoznaj samoga sebe. I to je mudrost koja je nesumnjivo važna i dan danas i dobro je tu staru mudrost da što pre usvojimo i da osvojimo, da se na vreme dakle, sa tim suočimo. A kada se pitamo o identitetu, kada se suočimo sa pitanjem dakle, samospoznaje, kada počnemo jednu dubinsku introspekciju, ko smo, kakva nam je priroda, zašto nas je Bog dao, šta valja da činimo da živimo u skladu sa sopstvenom prirodom, to je onda i formula za sopstvenu sreću. Ako radimo ono što volimo, što nam je Bog dao, onda ćemo imati osjećanje sreće, makoliko to sitno bilo. Ja mogu da vas podsjetim na recimo jedno pravoslavno predanje koje je jedan vrlo zanimljivi savremeni pesnik Blagoje Baković pretvorio jednu finu lirsku celinu u kojoj se jedan mrav uputi tragom svojih nekih opsesija u Carigrad. I stvarno su ga sretali na putu za Carigrad, pa kaže, pa kud si ti krenuo, ti si mrav, nikakav, ne možeš stići nikada u Carigrad i smeju mu se. On kaže, ništa vi ne brinite, meni je važno da ja budem na putu za Carigrad. Ne moram ja stići u Carigrad, ali ja sam na putu za Carigrad. E to je onda smisao zapravo života koji čovjek realizuje svojim malim individualnim postojanjem koji se meri na možda 70, 80, 90 godina, kako ko od nas živi, ali važno je da u tom kratkom vremenskom periodu koji proživljavamo, mi realizujemo neki dubinski smisao u koji verujemo. I zato je kultura, to je treći činilac nama u čitavoj ovoj raspravi neophodna, zato što nas kultura zapravo uči o svekolikim mudrostima životnim i ukazuje nam na istorijska saznanja koje nam otvaraju ovakve perspektive. Sva pitanja sa kojima se čovjek suočavao sa smislom postojanja, sa smislom sopstvene delatnosti, sa smislom svog boravka na ovom svetu, e, to samo kultura čini, to niko drugi ne čini. A kad kažem kultura, onda mislim naravno i na religiju, na istoriju, na filosofiju, na nauku itd. Sve ono zapravo što je od suštinske važnosti za čovekovo postojanje.
Kao što smo vas informisali u prethodnoj emisiji, pomen žrtvama Oluje prvi put je obeležen u srpskim crkvama u Kanadi, uz kratki program u sali Oplenca 5. avgusta ove godine. Na ovom značajnom događaju, između ostalih, prisustvovali su predstavnici diplomatskog kora u Kanadi, gradonačelnica Mississauge Bonnie Crombie, kao i profesor dr. Colin Campbell iz Hamiltona. U nastavku pogledajte što je naša kamera snimila na ovom događaju.
My name is Gordana Laković and I am your host for today. Our gathering has only two goals. First, to commemorate the victims of the said historical event. And second, to honor the sacrifice of Canadian men and women in uniform, the members of the United Nations Force who served during this event. Our guests today are His Excellency the Ambassador of Republic of Serbia in Canada, Mihailo Papazoglu, Her Worship Madame Mayor Bonnie Crombie of Mississauga, Consul General of the Republic of Serbia in Toronto, Mr. Vasilije Petković, and our special guest of the event, Dr. Colin C.M. Campbell. We will use this opportunity to present our new Consul General of the Republic of Serbia in Toronto, Mr. Vasilije Petković, and we will call for him to say a few words.
I would like to greet first our distinguished guest, Madam Crombie, Mr. Campbell, ladies and gentlemen. On August 5th, 22 years ago, in a military operation storm, the armed forces of the Republic of Croatia, supported by various phalanges and expertly consulted from abroad, expelled a quarter of a million of its own citizens of Serbian nationality. During this military operation, according to the official data, 2,313 Serbs were killed, of which 522 women and 12 children. These are the official figures. There are the other sources that says that these figures are much higher, but yet to be proved. Over 20,000 homes have been destroyed or damaged, which until today have not been rebuilt, restored, or fully paid off their value to expelled Serbs. The military operation Storm is officially declared by the International Crime Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia as a war crime supported by groups of organized crime, with the goal of ethnic cleansing of Serbs from the Republic of Croatia. Let us never forget these facts. However, during this unfortunate and tragic event, it should be noted that always mentioned that the members of the Canadian military within the United Nations peacekeeping forces, in accordance with the basic principles of United Nations, defended and protected Serbian people in the Republic of Croatia and had armed conflict with Croatian armed forces in which they suffered themselves as well. Let us never forget this act too of humanity for which they have eternal gratitude from Serbian people. The occasion of the 22nd anniversary of expelling Serbs from the Republic of Croatia here in Canada, however, provides an opportunity to emphasize the connection between the Serbian people and Canada. Seeking protection and security for their families, expelled Serbs from the Republic of Croatia first fled to Serbia, from where a number of them emigrated to Canada, where they found a new life, becoming Canadians themselves. Some would say they were lucky after all, but that was an act of destiny. Today, Canadians of Serbian descent give an exceptional contribution to Canadian society, enriching it not only in cultural and national sense, but in economical and political significance as well, thus making a great bridge between Serbian and Canadian people. This bridge provides an opportunity for mutual improvement and growth of relations between Serbia and Canada. As Christianity is teaching us, as well as the other peace-loving religions, this so unfortunate and tragic event must never be forgotten, but should be forgiven. Even though this occasion should be finished as it is now, I will finish it with following words. Long live Serbians, long live Canadians. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to present you His Excellency the Ambassador of the Republic of Serbia to Canada, Mr. Mihailo Papazoglou.
Dear citizens, dear dignitaries of the Serbian Orthodox Church here, their worship, dear Canadians, whoever thinks that what we just heard and the reason why we are here and is not convinced on that, let him go and check the number of expelled 22 years ago on the site of our chancellery for refugees. Whoever needs a proof how many people died, let him go and check the names of killed and missing persons on the site of Veritas. And whoever really thinks and needs an additional proof of what happened 22 years ago, let him go to the site of the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia in Hague and check what they were thinking about that. At least for one, they were right. But once again and again and again, we should also think about of the 2nd Battalion of Princess Light Infantry, Princess Patricia Light Infantry, that was a couple years ahead of what happened in 95 in the Operation Medak Pocket, was there for the Serbs who lived in this part of Croatia. At one point of time, even literally by imposing themselves in between the fire lines, they tried to save some 600 Serbs from Croatia. They did it with commitment and they did it with conviction. So once again, on today's day when Serbia mourns, we also honor this memory of Canadian soldiers that unfortunately, by saving 600, were not able to save 88 persons who were killed. So with these words, let us continue to be united. And also, as my colleague said, long live Serbia, long live Canada. Thank you very much.
A sada, poštovani gledaoci, uživajte uz Skud Oplenac. Televizija Toronto nastavlja prikazivanje isečaka iz dokumentarca Tower to the People, filma o Nikoli Tesli i njegovoj ideji o bežičnom prenosu električne energije. Ovaj američki dokumentarac, koji je premijerno prikazan 2014. godine na Srpskom filmskom festivalu u Torontu, govori o tome kako je kupljena poslednja Teslina laboratorija na Long Islandu.
Morgan controlled the banks, he controlled shipping, he controlled mining. He controlled everything.
I think J.P. Morgan was very much intrigued with Tesla. He had seen what Tesla had accomplished in alternating current.
So Tesla was invited to Morgan's house right after Thanksgiving. So after dinner, he met with Morgan and he explained to Morgan that he has a way to transmit messages around the world, and in particular, transmit messages from here to England.
He had as an idea that Tesla would be able to receive radio communications from Europe, perhaps so he could get the London stock market closing before anybody else, and he could act on that. So J.P. Morgan had a particular interest in that.
So they set out to form a partnership. Morgan says, I want to know exactly what you can do. And Tesla said, well, for $250,000, I can send messages to the Pacific Ocean all the way to Japan and China. And for $100,000, I can send it to Europe. And so Morgan says, let's just do one ocean at a time. I'll give you $150,000. Can you set up a wireless system from here to England? And Tesla agrees. Now, what Tesla didn't realize was that Morgan also attached the patents to the agreement. Tesla was just thinking they had a business relationship, but Morgan also wanted 50% of the patents, and he also attached the lighting patents. But he's writing a check for $150,000. So Tesla's kind of stuck, what should I do? So he agrees and he says to Morgan, you take 51%, I'll only take 49%, I trust you. You're a great philanthropist, you're a great man, let's do this thing. And so Morgan says, sure, I'll take the 51%. He was ready to do 50-50. And so they formed a deal. It wasn't just as a business deal. He saw it as a mechanism to help humanity move to the next level. Wardenclyffe, he understood, would change the very nature of how we deal with the world.
With Morgan's backing, Tesla looked within his social strata for the talent to execute the design plans for Wardenclyffe.
Nikola Tesla was a very popular person in Manhattan. He was a sort of an icon. Society people flocked to him because of his experiments.
Tesla lived in the world of Astoria at the height of the Gilded Age. Tesla's friends included John Jacob Astor, who owned the world of Astoria, Rudyard Kipling, Mark Twain. He knew Teddy Roosevelt.
Another esteemed member of Tesla's circle was renowned architect Stanford White, partner in the firm McKim, Mead & White.
Stanford White is one of my favorite guys. He designed Madison Square Garden. Madison Square Garden, at the time, was the tallest building in New York City. Designed Rosecliff, Newport, Tennis Hall of Fame, and many other buildings.
I'm related to Stanford White. Stanford White was my great-grandfather. There are a lot of things that you see walking in New York around Washington Square. You see the Arch, and then you see the Italian Age Cathedral. Not only did he like to design the buildings and so on, but he liked to design the parties. On some of those occasions, he called in Tesla to design the lighting. So it was sort of a full service kind of thing.
Stanford White was certainly one of the most prominent architects. And I think that just as a favor to Tesla, that he arranged to build the laboratory that would be next to the Wardenclyffe Tower.
He needed the greatest architect, he needed the greatest financier. This was an incredible triumvirate, and that was the triumvirate that Tesla was going to use to revolutionize the world.
Vreme za reklamne poruke. Ako želite da stejđirate ili dekorišete vaš dom, uključujući i Feng Shui konsultacije, nazovite Branku Miličević na 647-444-0771. Za profesionalno i povoljno dizajniranje web sajtova potražite TJ Hosting na 647-547-3061. Za brižljivu negu vaše kose i profesionalni savjet nazovite Elizabeth na 647-281-5501. Za kraj još jedna informacija. Skud Oplenac vas poziva na tradicionalno veče posvećeno vrelom jugu Srbije 4. novembra u 19 sati u MDG sali Skuda Oplenac. Ulaznica sa večerom je $50. Za rezervacije javite se na telefon 647-704-9942 ili na 905-274-6449. Također najavljujemo 17. festival srpskog filma u Torontu, koji će se održati od 2. do 5. novembra ove godine. Za više informacija posetite crossroadfilms.ca. Poštovani gledaoci, to je sve što smo spremili za danas. Hvala vam na pažnji, do sljedećeg viđenja, prijatno i doviđenja.